Jesus Christ was born on Christmas Day, and man will live forevermore because of Christmas Day. Long time ago in Bethlehem, so the Holy Bible said, Mary's boy child, Jesus Christ, was born on Christmas Day. Hark now, hear the angels sing, a king was born today, a man will live forevermore because of Christmas Day. Mary's boy child, Jesus Christ, was born on Christmas Day. While shepherds watch their flocks by night, they see a bright new shining star. They hear a
I was there, you know. To be honest, I wasn't in the best of moods that night. Times were tough. Economic uncertainty, I think the phrase is. And I knew that. As a self-employed shepherd struggling to make ends meet, the outlook was as bleak as the weather.
According to the papers, I had it all. I was young, rich, and a member of the royal family. A celebrity with the world at my feet from the day I was born. But somehow, it wasn't enough. There was something missing. I just didn't know what it was.
Well, I know you wouldn't think it to look at me now, but I played my part that night. In fact, I had the starring role. I was one of the main choreographers in the greatest opening ceremony the world has ever seen. Imagine having that on your CV.
And it wasn't just the money, or lack of it, that was getting me down. My wife had recently left me, and my youngest had just been caught stealing. I felt like I had the whole world on my shoulders.
I had a string of girlfriends, each more glamorous than the last. But still, that happy ever after feeling was eluding me. I endeavoured to find myself in various ways. You name it, I tried it. But I just ended up feeling more lost.
We spent an eternity rehearsing, getting everything just right. I assumed the audience would be a whole host of the brightest and best, but it turned out they were much more down to earth than that.
I've been passing the time with some of the other shepherds, huddling around the campfire to keep warm. They were having some stupid argument about who had the biggest flock. But I had other things on my mind.
I ended up throwing myself into astronomy, searching the night sky for answers to all my questions. I met some other stargazers, and together we came to know every inch of the heavens above us.
Do you know the best bit? The element of surprise. There we were, waiting silently in the wings, and they didn't have a clue.
Suddenly, the sky, which had been as black as my mood, burst into the brightest, most brilliant light. It was golden and warm, like that best feeling in the world. The others were terrified, but I just had the sense that, finally, things were looking up.
And that's when we saw the new star, where no star had been seen before. You couldn't miss it. It lit up the entire sky. And I knew, without a doubt, that this was what I'd been waiting for.
We were all champing at the bit to start the show. But first, there was a message to deliver.
Out of the light came a figure. Like a person, only not a person, if you know what I mean. Radiant is what he was. So radiant, even the sheepdogs didn't dare bark. He spoke to us, told us a baby had been born in town, and we were to go and see him.
Why did we follow the star? I don't know exactly. But when it started moving, we just knew it was leading us somewhere and we needed to follow it.
And that was our cue. Ta-da! Out we came, the grand finale. Oh, it was the best fun. Flying and floating, swooping and swooshing, gliding and singing. The harmonies were out of this world, if I do say so myself.
Now I know I'm already sounding like I'd had a bit too much to drink around the campfire, but there were people up there in the sky, thousands of them, flying around above our heads and singing their hearts out. Proof, as if it was needed, that this message about the baby really meant something.
We were on the road a long time. The star was always just ahead of us. We never quite knew what was round the corner, but we were confident we would reach our destination.
It was a shame when we had to stop. I could have gone on all night, but in reality, we were just the warm-up act. The headliner was the one they really needed to see.
So suddenly they were gone. And there we were in the dark and the silence, a bunch of confused and traumatised middle-aged shepherds. Well, there was nothing for it but to head for the town and find this baby. The others were convinced that if we didn't go, the glorious choir would come back for round two.
It's funny when you reach the end of a long journey. I was worried I might be disappointed after investing so much hope in where the star would lead us.
But as I stood there, outside the room, where the baby was,
I thought, I've come all this way.
I might as well at least stick my head around the door.
And say to the little one,
welcome to our world.
Our crazy, confused and messed up world.
But as soon as I saw him,
I felt him say,
I know.
That's why I'm here.
And he's been here all along.
You come to St. Peter's Rushden, you get songs, you get film, you get good-looking congregations. There's nothing lacking in this evening's service. Really good to see you. For those of you, I hit 60 this year. I don't know whether I have an R or an O, really. We'll try and do that again. I hit 60 this year. I'll go with the R. Unbelievable, isn't it? It's the word you were looking for, unbelievable. But for those of you of a certain age, do you remember David Coleman used to do football commentary, athletics commentary and so on? Do you remember that? Here's a quote from David Coleman from about 30 years ago, commentating on a Liverpool game. Keegan was there with the precision of a surgeon's knife. Bang! Now, I just want to say, if you have a surgeon with a knife, the word you don't want to hear after that is bang. Okay? And sometimes it has to be said that David Coleman and many since couldn't quite find the right words. The right words weren't always there. Just, I remember him saying once, Sebastian Coe was literally going backwards for the last 100 metres. Well, that just can't be true, can it? So people don't always find the right words. What are your favourite Christmas hits? When I go around in the car, which I do a lot of, I'm always listening to the radio, usually Radio 5, I have to say, because I do like my sport. But occasionally, other things. And at the moment, wherever you turn on to, you get a whole lot of Christmas music. What are your favourite Christmas hits? One of my favourites of all time is Bing Crosby singing, I'm dreaming of a white Christmas, just like the ones I used to know. I've got a tear in my eye, lump in my throat. Do you know that one? Yeah, of course you do. Of course you do. I have to say global warming makes that increasingly unlikely that we'll have a white Christmas, but there we go. Or do you remember Jonah Lomu? No, that's Jonah Lomu. He's the big New Zealand winger, isn't he? Jonah Louie doing Stop the Cavalry. Do you remember that one? And he sums up the real meaning of Christmas with these words. Dum-ba-dum-ba-dum-dum-dum-ba-dum-dum-dum-ba-dum-dum-ba-dum-dum-ba-dum. And in case you didn't get it the first time, then it repeats. It goes dum-ba-dum-ba-dum-dum-ba-dum-dum-ba-dum-dum-ba-dum-dum-ba-dum-dum-ba-dum. The real meaning of Christmas from Jonah Louie. Or maybe you go for the Pogues with A Fairy Tale of New York. Now, I have to say, I'm not going to sing most of these words to you for all sorts of different reasons, but reason one is we're in church. But, of course, the ones that people remember most of all is the boys of the NYPD choir were singing Galway Bay and the bells were ringing out for Christmas Day. And it's all very lovely and it kind of gets me in the Christmas mood, but does it get to the heart of the meaning of Christmas? Maybe not. Maybe it misses it. Sometimes the right words, as David Coleman would have agreed, the right words are just hard to find. Some of the carols have a really good go at it. I have to say, I've enjoyed singing the carols tonight. This morning I was in another place in Northampton, and they were still on Advent, and so they were doing lots of Advent hymns, and it's just a joy to come and sing carols. Thank you very much. I do like carols. I love Christmas. And some of the carols get it just right. The heavenly babe you there shall find, to human view displayed. That's lovely, isn't it? You could write books on that sentence alone, heaven touching earth. Or, so God imparts to human hearts the blessings of his heaven, heaven touching earth. Or you get veiled in flesh, the Godhead see, hail the incarnate deity, heaven touching earth. Just the right words are sometimes tricky to find. But those hymn writers, they were coming maybe closer than Jonah, what's his name again? Jonah Louie. Just keep wanting to say Jonah Lomu with his dubba dubba dum dum. These hymn writers are getting a lot closer to the meaning of Christmas, heaven touching earth. Or you get to that reading from John chapter 1. You know, in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. And you get to that part later on, the light, talking about Jesus, the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. They're great words. What Christmas is about, the light shines in the darkness and the darkness has not overcome it. In 1939, George VI, King George VI, had to do his Christmas broadcast. And he had a dreadful situation in front of him because this darkness was settling across Europe. And the Nazi war machine was walking across Europe. And he wanted something inspiring to say to his people. And Christmas 1939. And his daughter, Princess Elizabeth, gave him a poem. And the poem was by a lady called Minnie Louise Haskins. And the poem said this, and King George VI read it out in Christmas 1939, before, from Britain's point of view, the war had really, really got going. I said to the man who stood at the gate of the year, "Give me a light that I may tread safely into the unknown." And he replied, "Go out into the darkness and put your hand into the hand of God, and that shall be to you better than light and safer than a known way." Just the right words. He did better than David Coleman. He did better than some of those songwriters. Just the right words for that Christmas occasion with a nation under pressure and a world under pressure. Does it ring any bells? A world under pressure. A world facing some uncertain times. Maybe a COVID pandemic. Omicron on the march across Europe. And the advice remains the same at Christmas. Go out into the darkness and put your hand into the hand of God. That should be safer to you than a known way. In what seems years ago, but was in fact about a year and a half ago, at the start of the pandemic, some UK churches released something called the UK Blessing. And if you haven't heard it, when you go home tonight, Google it on YouTube, the UK Blessing, and it's a song that you'll probably know well. You'll have heard it a lot on the radio at the time. I did in my car. I'm making myself sound like I do nothing except listen to the radio in my car. I do other work as well. And yet, do have a look at that when you go home. It's worth looking at. And I just want to read you some of these words. At the start of the film clip, it says this: "Churches around the UK have come together at this time to sing a blessing over the nation." Bit like the angels over Bethlehem, to sing a blessing over the nation. And the song begins in familiar Bible territory. The opening words of the song are these: "The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace." And then it goes on to say this as it goes through the song: "May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you. He is with you in the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you. He is for you." And it repeats over and over again at the end: "He is for you. He is for you." And if you forget everything else this Christmas time, remember that Jesus, who was born in Bethlehem, in that time of darkness in his land, he is for you. He is for you. He is with you. He is with you. Just the right words as Omicron takes root in the country. Just the right words to hear in any Christmas. He is for you. Every preacher should give the congregation hope. And here is your hope. I've nearly finished. And I'm nearer the end of this sermon than I am at the beginning, which, you know, I'd have to be by definition, wouldn't I? I have to warn you that I do occasionally have a couple of finalies, two lastlies, and three as I come towards a close. But here's my first finally. The Bible says that when Mary and Joseph gave their son his name, they called him Jesus, which means Savior. And you'll probably hear more of that on Christmas Day. But they also called him Emmanuel, which means God is with us. He is for you. He is with you. Whatever we face, he is for you and he is with you. Final story. One Christmas, a friend of mine called Phil, who's a Baptist minister, got onto a train from Peterborough and was heading towards London King's Cross. And he said, as usual, when you buy a ticket for a train, he was left with no seat and was standing. And he said, "I was standing here in the sort of corridor bit." And he said, "There was a fellow from the army standing within touching distance here and his daughter next to him and a sort of businessman in a stripy suit about here. And everyone packed in together." It was pre-COVID, by the way. Everyone packed in together. And he said, "The soldier was having a monumental argument with his teenage daughter, and they didn't bother to lower their voice. And the whole carriage had gone quiet to listen. It was like a spectator sport. Everyone was getting their popcorn out and listening. At the end of it, she said to her dad, "I hate you." And she pushed her way down to the far end of the carriage and went into the next carriage. And the soldier who was standing here in front of Phil had some tears rolling down his cheeks. And he said to Phil, who hadn't got the excuse of wearing a collar, he just opened up to the person in front of him. He said, "She hates me. My wife's left me. And I can't stand my job. And nobody loves me." And there was a quiet on the carriage. And Phil said to him, boldly, I think, and probably with his heart pounding, because everyone was listening, and he said, "I didn't want to sound trite." He said, "But I said to him, 'God loves you.'" And the soldier said, "Really?" He said, "Yeah, God loves you." And he said, "We're nearly at Christmas." And then Phil went on to tell him a bit about the Christmas story and about the God who so wants to be with us and never wants to be away from us. And the God who says, whatever we face, he faces with us. "I am for you, I am for you, I'm with you." And at the end of that, there was another silence in the carriage. And then the soldier said, "Will you pray for me?" And Phil said, "As soon as I get home, I'll pray for you." And the soldier said, "Will you pray for me now?" He said, "I mean, will you pray for me now?" He said, "I need you to pray for me now." And Phil said, "I was very aware that there was this businessman here and somebody else here and everyone sitting there and everyone was listening. And so," he said, "I just put one hand on his shoulder and I prayed that that Jesus, the Prince of Peace, would give peace to this man and that the Jesus who heals broken lives would bring healing to that man." And he said, "And I said at the end of it, 'Amen.'" And the guy said, "Amen." And there was a silence on the carriage again. And then this businessman leant forward with his stripy suit and he said rather condescendingly to the soldier, "Lucky, weren't you, that the vicar was on the train today?" And Phil said, "God's always on the train. Wherever you go, God's always on the train. Emmanuel, God with us. Jesus, the one who will never let us go. He is with us, he is with us. He is for us, he is for us. The one who we remember at Christmas can never be separated from us." Can I encourage you? Pandemics are big, but it'll go. It'll become, what's the other word I'm looking for? Endemic? Is that right? Anyway, it'll become less of the headlines. It'll come and go. And this Jesus we talk about was the Jesus who George VI spoke about at Christmas 1939. And who Phil talked about on the train, and who will see us from our cradle to our grave, and who said one day we'll see him face to face. I'd encourage you this Christmas to let Jesus, the light of the world, shine in your life, to put your hand, as Minnie Louise Haskins said, into the hand of God, and may Emmanuel, God with us, be with you. You have a great Christmas. Amen.
Let us pray. When I say, "Lord, in your mercy," please respond, "Hear our prayer." Father God, we thank you that we can meet with you and with one another in this beautiful church. As the evening is lit with candles and we remember once again the story of your birth, we thank you for the opportunity to share in this time of worship, of sacred words, and of music together. Let your light shine into our hearts. Let us feel your presence as we draw close to you this Christmas season. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, there is still darkness and uncertainty in our world. We bring all our anxieties, hopes, and dreams to you and gently place them before the child in the manger. You who gave up so much for us know us better than we know ourselves. you know what we need. Bring us peace in our hearts, we pray. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we thank you for those who work hard for others, particularly those developing, delivering, and receiving vaccinations. We pray for an end to this pandemic that has swept across our world. We ask for strength for those who are exhausted, healing of emotional pain, and courage for those struggling to adapt to change. We ask that you will walk with us and guide us through this strange time. Shine your light into our hearts that we might be sustained by you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father God, as we share in the joy of the shepherds in discovering you anew, we bring before you those for whom this time of year is particularly hard. In a moment of quiet, we have the opportunity to silently name anyone we would particularly like to bring before the Lord this evening. Father, surround all of those we have named and all of those who are sick or suffering in any way. We ask that you will surround them all in your loving care and protection. We ask comfort for the bereaved, love for the lonely, and a safe place to stay for everyone. We think particularly of the homeless and sufferers of domestic abuse. Guide those in need to the agencies and the resources that can help them. And give those in authority ears to hear and eyes to see what needs to be done. Show us how to be good friends and good neighbours, loving one another as you have first loved us. Where there are rifts, Lord, show us a healthy way forwards. Shine the light of your love into our families and into our community, Lord, we pray. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father God, the wise men brought their best and finest gifts for Jesus. As we exchange gifts together this Christmas, we thank you for all that we have and enjoy together. We pray now for those who do not have all that they need. We pray for the hungry and for those who struggle in war-torn ruins. Guide world leaders to wisdom and bring peace to this earth. And finally, Lord God, who loved us so much that you would come and meet us as a tiny, helpless babe, fill us with your love. Fill us so full that we overflow, and let your love overflow out of us into the world around us, so that everyone might know you and your great love for us all this Christmas time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now let's draw all our prayers and praises together and pray as our Father, as Jesus taught us, teaching us to call God our Father so that we have the courage to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.